All right, continuing on, we're going to be talking about the false doctrine, learn to love yourself. And this is one I've wanted to cover on audio recording for quite some time now because I'm really tired of hearing this false doctrine being passed around everywhere, mostly because I bought into it at one time. And that's, I guess I'm a little embarrassed about that I ever bought into this false teaching. But if you guys want to follow along, you can go to creationliberty.com. Just type in the word love into the search bar at creationliberty.com. You will get an article called False Doctrine, Learn to Love Yourself. Or if you're listening by YouTube, you can click on the description. Go down to the description. There's a link in there. You can click on that and you can follow along. So, this love yourself message. I mean, most people claiming to be Christians do not have any good understanding of what the Bible says about love, which is why I want to spend some time on this today. Now, the last time I did a teaching on this, or at least when I shared an article on this, I could get almost nobody to even look at it. It's like people don't even want to see, like, oh, love, I understand that because, we have loving hearts and all that, so I don't need to read anything on this. Wait a second. I'm going to go into the definitions of love in the Bible, and I'm telling you, most of you who are listening to this, you don't. If you think you have a good understanding of this, likely you don't have a good understanding of it, because I have heard almost nobody teach on this properly. No, I don't want to say almost no one. I've never heard this teach on this properly. Anyone teach this properly? I've never. Yeah, never that I can recall. I'm not saying there's none. I'm saying that I don't hear it. So I'm going to give you the scripture on what exactly the Bible says about the love of God and how we share the love of God. And it's not what you think, okay? If for those of you who don't really fully understand it is not what you think. So first, let's look at the heresy that's being taught. I'm going to give you a bunch of examples, and there's some stuff we can listen to here too. But first, I'm going to quote this from this guy who's a Christian psychiatrist. Now, first of all, if you have to put the adjective Christian in front of the word psychiatrist, I think you're a liar. I'm sorry. I don't see how somebody could be a Christian and a psychiatrist at the same time. Psychiatry, the entire focus of it is based on a lie. I mean, we have to get into the whole the documents they use to try to discern illnesses. And listen, I'm telling you, I know some people are going to get offended by this. But anybody who claims to be a Christian and is a psychiatrist is ignorant on the Word of God. Okay, I mean, the fact of the matter that everything they deal in is pharmaceutical based, and the root word for pharmaceuticals is sorcery, pharmakia. I mean, this is what they dabble in is sorcery, and I have never seen psychiatrists do good. There's people who will object to that as well because they don't understand what good is. Okay, I have seen people, watched people die through the prescriptions of psychiatrists. Okay, I don't see how anybody, if someone claims to be a Christian psychiatrist, beware. I would not trust that person any farther that I can directly see them. Okay. Because they don't have the knowledge of the Word of God in them. And that's a long other topic I'm not going to spend too much time on. But anyway, here's this Christian psychiatrist in a book called Christian Child Rearing and Personal Development. Okay, I don't really need a psychiatrist to tell me about personal development either. I don't want to hear it because they're going to bring in a lot of new age false doctrine concepts that they basically get in college. Okay, I just took some psychology courses in college, and I can tell you how much wickedness is involved in that either. And it's so funny because the world, what they'll teach you in college, and I know this is off topic, but I just want to mention this as we go by. In a college classroom, they will teach you that mankind is just unpredictable, and you have to be prepared for all sorts of things because they're totally unpredictable. Now that I have studied the Bible thoroughly, and I still have a lot of work, but now that I've studied the Bible thoroughly, I say that is incorrect. The Bible teaches us about the hearts of mankind, and mankind is incredibly predictable. And most, I mean, because in Ecclesiastes chapter 1, it says there is no new thing under the sun. So what they've done before, they're going to continue to do. Once you understand sin and sin in the heart, mankind becomes incredibly predictable. Which is why so many people have gotten frustrated with me when I've said, okay, here's what this person's going to do. I remember having friends, and people have falsely taken me for some sort of prophet for predicting the future. No, it's simply reasonable by the scripture, okay? I remember I had a friend a long time ago, he's no longer a friend, but 2 or 3 years, well, how many years was it? No, it was 3 or 3 to 4 years, something around there. About 3 to 4 years before he divorced his wife, we had kind of went our separate ways because he just quit listening to everything. And I told us, because I was still talking and friends with a couple of his friends, and I told him, I said, he's going to divorce his wife. He's going to leave his wife and his children. He's going to leave them. Just give it some time, and that's going to happen. And it's what they had ended up telling me is later they had told him that after he had done it. He says, you know, because he no longer liked me at all because of some things I was telling him or rebuking him on, but he just could not stand me. And they went and told him, it's like, you know, he told us that you were going to leave her, and he was right. And then he got really angry at that, and they said, you know the funny part? He also told us if you tell him, he's going to get really angry that I told you that. So that may even matter. So I mean, I don't even know why that just came up in my head. But anyway, the point is that there are people I knew by his actions, by his words, things he was doing, and things he was telling me, and the fact that he was not repented. I knew he wasn't a Christian, and I knew exactly what he was going to do. But just given enough time, as he continued in that corruption, exactly what he was going to do, because the Bible tells us these things. This is what people go to. So anyway, that's a whole nother topic. But continuing here, let's get on the topic of that learn to love yourself false doctrine. Here's what this supposed Christian in quotation psychiatrist says, quote, "People who don't love themselves in a healthy way will find it impossible to develop genuine love relationships with others. Two of the most important concepts I learned from my psychiatric training, both of which are totally with scripture." So you see what he's saying already is that, oh, these are totally in line with scripture. Here you go. He says, number one, you cannot truly love others until you learn to love yourself in a healthy way. And number two, lack of self-worth is the basis of most psychological problems. End quote. Okay, now most of you, whether you've read books, whether you've gone to church buildings or whatever, you have heard this message preached sometime or another. And I just went out and started finding some other examples because I know that these teachings are a dime a dozen, all right? And so let's listen to this guy talk for a minute. I couldn't even find the name of who this guy was, but you know, he's some Christian preacher up on his pulpit preaching to his audience. And let's listen to this guy for a moment.
How much does God love you, and how does He love you? He loves you unconditionally. You understand?
He loves you unconditionally. Let me ask you guys, do you think that's true? Does God love everyone unconditionally?
I don't think so.
Why would you say that?
Well, for instance, Jacob have I loved, and Esau have I hated.
Yeah, why would it, he said that when they were still in the womb, didn't he? Well, why would he say that?
Esau did evil and Jacob did righteousness.
So, did he love them unconditionally and equally?
Nope.
Okay, so we could tell this guy's already teaching some false doctrine, isn't he? Okay, so there's, of course, now God does love the sinner. I'm not saying that he doesn't, okay, because he can change them and bring them salvation, but he doesn't bring them into salvation as they are. He changes them and brings them in. So are there conditions on which we are saved? Because the Bible says that he resisteth the proud and gives grace to the humble. He doesn't love them without condition, okay? Because there are certain things he has to, like for example, because people, as soon as I say something like that, they're going to bring up the prodigal son. The parable of the prodigal son, you know, he leaves and he goes and he ends up broke, spends all of his money, and he's living in this pigsty. And then when he comes home, the father accepts him in. Okay, and he's more excited about this one that was lost that he brought in than the ones that were doing righteousness and you know, good the whole time, right? He's excited over that one that can be saved, which is true. But here's the question I have, and they say, well, you see, that's unconditional love. Wait a second, let me show you real unconditional love. Let me show you what this means, because the Bible doesn't use that phrase. Real unconditional love would mean the father would go hunt out this son when he was broken, living in the pigsty, and he would give him more money. And say, no, here's some more so that way you don't have to suffer anything. Now that, you see, and then he would continue in his wickedness. You see, there was a condition on the love. He had to return from his wickedness, okay? And of course, God has to give us repentance to the acknowledging of the truth. So God gives us those things in his timing, not our own. Anyway, let's continue here.
I ask a question in the sessions, and I'll ask this question with you as well. How many of you here tonight love yourself exactly the way you are?
Well, I'll pose the same question he did. How many of you love yourself exactly the way you are? Think carefully about your answer.
I don't.
Well, go ahead and give a description of what you mean. What do you mean?
Me? Well, because I still sin sometimes.
Yeah, so do I, and I hate that too.
Flesh.
Okay, so what you're saying when you said you, are you defining yourself by the flesh or the spirit?
You as being in the flesh.
Oh, you see, there you go. So what you just did, and here's what he did too. He did not allow them to identify themselves properly, because as born-again Christians, we now have a flesh and a spirit separate from one another, where the spirit is cleansed into righteousness, but the flesh is still wicked, right? But the unbeliever has the sin and the flesh still both in wickedness united as one. So when they identify themselves, they're identifying themselves by the flesh. When we identify ourselves, we typically ought to do it by the Spirit, okay? That though my flesh sins, now I'm in righteousness, okay, under the Lord Jesus Christ, but still recognizing that we do still sin of the flesh and that we have to war against it on a regular basis. But, and that's a whole teaching for people who don't understand that. There's an article we have called Do Christians Sin? Just type in the word sin at creationliberty.com and you can read more about that to get an understanding of what all that is. So that's what he's asking them. Do any of you love yourselves? Now watch what happens.
Interesting, isn't it? In all the sessions we've done, last night was the first time anybody ever raised their hand. And my question to you is why?
So he expected them all to raise their hands. You know, you should be loving yourself, you know, and you should just like everything about yourself all the time. Wait a second. What about the flesh with the spirit? He doesn't talk about any of that because this guy is not preaching truth. Now, I'm going to skip ahead for just a moment here and let's listen to what he has to say.
Absolutely. Now, he also says that you're to love your neighbor as yourself, correct? Okay, when I ask you how many of you love yourself exactly the way that you are, nobody raised your hand. So how do you love God properly when you can't love yourself properly? How do you love your neighbor properly when you can't love yourself properly?
Oh, revelation. Oh, man, look at this great revelation now. We gotta love ourselves. Folks, I reacted in the same exact way that a lot of these people will react. Oh, man, I do have to love myself first. And this is the way they get all emotional about that. Oh, man, now I can just focus on me. Me, me, me. Wonderful. Of course that's what they want. They love to talk about themselves. That's what their favorite thing in the world. Here's another worldly... this female author, she wrote a book called Loving Yourself More, 101 Meditations for Women. Well, ladies, she says, quote, love your neighbor as yourself. Many women today are realizing that they have kept the first part of this commandment too well and the second part too poorly, end quote. Ladies, the problems in your life... you're just not loving yourself enough. That's what these teachers are saying. Let's listen to this other heretic you guys may be familiar with named Joyce Meyer. I made this video just yesterday. I spent all day yesterday working on some renovations for some of this stuff, and I made this video specifically for this teaching. Let's take a listen to what this heretic has to say.
Find out how a healthy view of yourself helps you love your life.
And I believe when somebody doesn't like themselves, it's equivalent to being emotionally ill. It's not the way that God wants us to function in this life. You are not supposed to have negative feelings about yourself.
How many of you could use liking yourself a little bit better? I mean, seriously, how many of you know that you maybe got kind of a bad attitude toward yourself and you need to come up higher in how you feel about yourself? I felt it was a major breakthrough when I simply discovered that most people really don't like themselves. Some of them know it, while others don't even have a clue that it's the root of many of the other problems in their life. Self-rejection and even self-hatred are the root causes of many relationship problems.
Now, she said self-rejection and self-hatred are the cause of many relationship problems. Really? Really? This is what she goes on to say. She's like, you know what, actually, let me just let her finish. I think I'm just going to let her finish this up, and then we'll talk about some things she said.
So if you don't like yourself, you are in for one miserably wretched life. So he says, you shall love the Lord your God with all your heart, with all your soul, with all your mind, with all your strength. Verse 39 says, well, first he says, verse 38, this is the great and the most important principle and the first commandment. Loving God is the first and the most important thing we have to do. Secondly, you shall love your neighbor as you do yourself. Love your neighbor as you love yourself. Well, guess what? If you don't love yourself, then you're not going to be able to love anybody else. And I believe when somebody doesn't like themselves, it's equivalent to being emotionally ill. How important it is to say what God says about you and not just say what other people have said to you or what you think or feel or what the devil's telling you. It's evil to speak negative about yourself. Well, I've been encouraging you today to love your life and love yourself so you can reach out to other people in love.
Now, did you hear what she said there at the end? To love your life and love yourself, even though John 12:25 says, he that loveth his life shall lose it, and he that hateth his life in this world shall keep it unto life eternal. Now, before we even go on to talk about some of the things she said there, if you went back and you listened to the whole teaching she did on the subject, Meyer goes on to, she tells the audience to never let anyone tell you that you're being too emotional, because what she claimed was that emotions come from the soul. She says emotions, that's part of your soul. And since Christ has cleansed the soul, therefore whatever you feel is righteous. That is a lie from the pit of hell. That is what is deceiving all these churchgoers into saying, well, I felt the Holy Spirit tell me. Which 9 times out of 10, when I've heard people say that, the next thing that comes out of their mouth is false. That's how these New Age cults are getting so popular, because they don't care what the Word of God says. Everyone ends up just believing whatever they feel like doing. Well, if I feel it, then it's from God. And she teaches that exact same message, folks. Now she says, if you don't like yourself, you're in from one miserable, wretched life. It's all about loving your life. That's everything that she teaches, okay? And that's why I love to quote John 12:25 to people who follow Joyce Meyer. Because the problem is they don't have any concept of what the scripture actually says, because they're too busy following Joyce Meyer's cult. So now let's see what the Bible says. You've heard all these people say, learn to love yourself. You got to love yourself before you can love others. Okay? Love yourself. Focus on yourself. 2 Timothy chapter 3, starting verse 1. Know this also, that in the last days perilous times shall come, for men shall be lovers of their own selves. I'm sorry, did that say that wonderful times will come? That said perilous times shall come. Perilous, folks, that is dangerous. That is times of grief. Times of suffering are coming because men shall be lovers of their own selves. They're covetous. Well, covetous, that couldn't possibly describe Joyce Meyer with her, you know, $10 million jet and her $20 million office and her multi-million dollar office furniture, right? They couldn't be covetous. Boasters, proud, blasphemers, disobedient to parents, unthankful, unholy, without natural affection, truce breakers, false accusers, incontinent, fierce, despisers of those that are good, traitors, heady, high-minded, lovers of pleasures more than lovers of God. Having a form of godliness, that means they're going to appear to be godly people, like these, we're appearing to be Christian, and oh, we're Christian preachers, oh yeah, we're having a form of godliness, but denying the power thereof, from such turn away. Now that, I don't care what you want to believe. God is describing the hearts of the people in the final days. I don't care what people want to say about themselves, because I don't trust men. Okay, I don't put my trust in men, I'm putting my trust in God, that what God says about the hearts of mankind in the flesh is true. And so from when I read things like this, I said, then I need to be guarded against my heart, because my flesh will want to do things that my spirit knows that in order to follow God, I ought not to do, and I need to war against that, okay? And so you also have to stop and consider, did that say that men were going to become haters of their own selves? No, it said become lovers of their own selves. In the end times, you know, when Jesus Christ said, you know, that you're going to need unbiblical female pastors to come and help you learn how to love yourself more. You see, the people become the lovers of their own selves. They rebel against the teachings of the Lord Jesus Christ because they want to go by their feelings instead of by the Word, which is the same mistake. You know, we were just talking about Jacob have I loved and Esau have I hated. You know, when you go back to the example of Isaiah, how is Isaiah tricked? Well, he was tricked because he went by the feeling instead of by the Word. What did he do? He says, you sound like Jacob, but you feel like Esau. He went by the feeling instead of by the Word. That was another lesson for us there.
Said that was Isaac, not Isaiah.
Oh, I'm sorry. We were reading Isaiah so much, I totally messed that up. Yes, it was Isaac that did that. Sorry, I apologize for that. I appreciate you correcting me on that. But anyway, so if we go to Romans chapter 7 and verse 24, it says, "O wretched man that I am, who shall deliver me from the body of this death?" Now that's the attitude I'm seeing lacking in the body of Christ. "O wretched man that I am." But wait a second, I thought Joyce Meyer said that it's bad, it's emotionally ill for anyone to have any negative feelings about themselves, right? But Paul said this. She's telling you that Paul was wrong. That is exactly what she just said. She has no repentance in her heart. She has no concept. Because we talked about that in the teaching, the last Sunday teaching we did. I know it's been a couple weeks because I was ill. She has no concept of being brought low because she's never repented. In Psalm chapter 8, verses 3 through 4, it says, "When I consider the heavens, the works of thy fingers, the moon and the stars, which thou hast ordained, what is man that thou art mindful of him, and the son of man that thou visitest him?" The same things in the book of Job, if you go look up what Job had to say. He says, "What is man that thou art mindful of him?" In Isaiah 2:12, it says, "For the day of the Lord of hosts shall be upon every one that is proud and lofty, and upon every one that is lifted up he shall be brought low." Well, it's great. We ought to give God praise when someone that is lifted up is brought low. There's a lot more verses we could talk on that. But, you know, you've got Meyer sitting back with her mega millions of wealth, thinking she's of need and nothing, and that her gain is godliness. She thinks she is blessed of God for all that she's gained. But 1 Timothy 6:5 says, "Perverse disputings of men of corrupt minds and destitute of the truth, supposing that gain is godliness, from such withdraw thyself." We should have nothing to do with that woman. In Revelation chapter 3 and verse 17, it says, "Because thou sayest, I am rich and increased with goods and have need of nothing, and knowest not that thou art wretched and miserable and poor and blind and naked." You see, well, wretched, that's negative. Miserable's negative. Poor is negative. Blind, that's negative. Naked, that's negative. Those are negative things. Folks, it's not about what's negative or positive. It's about what's true. And Meyer, as well as these other heretics I just quoted, teaching this heresy, the problem is that they don't have a mindfulness of the truth. They just have a mindfulness of things that make them feel good. All right? And in her teaching, Meyer said that self-hatred was the root cause of relationship problems. That's what she was teaching. And that people just need to love themselves more. And the example I give is that, you know, some of you ladies may have listened to a friend or somebody like that that she's in a marriage and she talks about how her husband may have beaten her, hit her, abused her like that. When she talks about her husband, does she say, "You know, I listened to Joyce Meyer and I think he just doesn't love himself enough"? That's preposterous. Nobody says that. The problem is he probably loves himself too much. And Joyce Meyer herself gives this whole long sob story. Again, we talk about that in the last teaching we did. You just go back to, or just go on the website, type in the word Joyce. Just type in Joyce into the search bar and you'll get the article we wrote on her. But she gives this long story about how she was raped by her father over 200 times. Well, I suppose when she was being raped by her father, she was thinking, man, you know, he probably just needs to love himself more. Yeah, I'm sure that's the first thing that was going through her head at the time. This is a false message that's claimed to be based on Christ's doctrine. Because again, let me read you Matthew chapter 22. This is starting verse 36 from the King James Bible. Because again, a lot of these heretics, they all use their New Age Bibles. And we want to get it from a preserved word instead. It says, Master, which is the great commandment of the law? And Jesus said unto him, Thou shalt love the Lord thy God with all thy heart, and with all thy soul, and with all thy mind. This is the first and great commandment. And the second is like unto it. Thou shalt love thy neighbor as thyself. On these two commandments hang all the law and the prophets. Now, what they're saying is that you can't love your neighbor, you can't love God until you love yourself first. That is a total contradiction to 2 Timothy chapter 3, where it says, there shall be perilous times where men are going to become lovers of their own selves. Okay, looking towards themselves and loving themselves first and foremost is what they're going to be doing. Nowhere in what I just read you in Matthew chapter 22 did it tell us we need to learn to love ourselves in order to do these things. It's telling us to do these things, to love the Lord God with all your heart, soul, mind, and strength, and then love your neighbor as you already love yourself. That is what it is telling us to do. Because every single one of you already love yourselves. Every one of you. Okay? In Ephesians chapter 5, verse 29, it says, For no man ever hated his own flesh, but nourisheth it and cherisheth it, even as the Lord the church. Now stop right here for a moment, because what are the first thing that somebody that you tell them these things? You already love yourself. They're going to say, but what about suicidal people? Before you even answer the question, you need to make sure that you point out that they are not on the foundation of the Word of God. Don't let somebody drag you into a place where you've got to be on the defensive, because they are the ones not staying on the Word of God. My first question to them is, are you saying that the Lord God contradicts himself? Because he's the one that has told us that no man has ever yet hated his own flesh. Are you telling me that God is wrong? That is exactly what they just told you. They're going to scramble around and be like, okay, they are the ones that said that. And you need to point that out first and foremost. But with this, let's go ahead and address the question, okay? After you point out that they're off the foundation of the Word, let's address the question. Because I am a person that was suicidal when I was a teenager. And again, with suicide victims, you have to remember that the ones that are vocal about it, see, I was not one that was vocal about it. The ones that talk about it a lot and say, well, I'm going to go kill myself and things like that, those are not the ones you have to worry about. I mean, 99% of the time, they are not going to do it. Okay? Don't be that concerned. It's the ones that don't say anything, those are the ones that you need to be concerned about, because those are the ones that will do it. But I'm telling you, as someone from a first-person point of view, see, every time I talk about this issue, people bring this stuff up as if I've had no personal experience with it. Because people listen to me today and they think, oh, he doesn't seem like someone like that. Well, folks, that's because I have been healed by the Lord Jesus Christ, okay? And again, these are things that I have grown and have to train myself, okay? I was the kind of person, I could not say hello to someone without shaking. My hands would just shake back and forth visibly by saying hello to someone. I used to be like that. And people think, it kind of irritates me, and I realize I understand what they're trying to get across, but it kind of irritates me when people say, oh man, I've had emails just in the past few weeks, oh, you have a gift of speaking and a gift of explaining things. Listen, I've had to work very hard to do this. This was not something I was just handed on a silver platter, but you see, people listen to me now, they have not known me for the past 30 years, so they don't know how hard I've worked to do this. I'm trying to explain that to people because I want them to know that if I can do what I'm doing right now, then what excuse do the rest of you have? None of you have an excuse. I've just taken away your excuse because I've worked hard enough to do that, okay? I'm not trying to lift myself up here. I'm trying to take away people's excuses that we need to do what the Lord God has called us to do and commanded us to do in His Word. He has never sent me a letter or given me a phone call ever telling me what to do. He gave me His Word. His Word, I have commandments just in Matthew chapter 28, which says, go into all the nations and preach the gospel and teach them the things I have commanded you, and I'm with you always. Okay, well, I read that, and I follow it. You don't need your pastor's permission. You don't need to go through a political system. You just need to follow the commandment. So anyway, blah, 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 getting past that. Okay, as a person who is suicidal, I can give you a first-person perspective, but I'll ask you guys a question. You know, if you're thinking about someone that you've ever known that was suicidal, or that you've ever even heard of that was suicidal, or somebody gave you a portrayal on a TV show or something of someone suicidal, do they clothe themselves? Do they eat food when they're hungry? Now, some of them might eat a little less. I mean, that's when I was, you know, suicidal, depressed, that kind of thing, I was eating less. Okay, but I did eat. Do they bathe themselves? Do they drink water when they're thirsty? Do they wear warm clothes when it's cold outside? Do they seek shelter from heat? These people do those things. Absolutely, they do those things. Okay? Why? Because they love themselves. Because for no man yet hated his own flesh. Now, of course, there's also some extreme things that you might read about where you talk about some of the zombie epidemic stuff. I've not written about this kind of stuff yet, but that's where the people were, you know, I've already heard of police reports where multiple police were chasing a person that's running naked through, you know, and they could not bind this person down because they were so demon possessed. You see, the news never reports on that stuff, that they're actually possessed by demons, as they were in the Bible when Jesus Christ cast out these devils. But they're possessed by all these devils, and the police can't hold them down. And as the police are trying to chase this person, they're actually tearing out pieces of their skin and their organs and throwing them at the cops. That kind of stuff has happened. Well, you see, well, they're saying, well, doesn't that person hate their own flesh? Well, no, that's a devil doing that to them, okay? That's the difference between those things. I mean, that's extreme stuff. But just taking on the position of even suicidal depressed people, even they love themselves, and they don't realize that they do. What they need is for someone else to listen to them and to care about them for a while. What they feel like is that no one cares about them, okay? What they need is for some people to spend some time with them. That's what they're really looking for. And so it's not that they don't love themselves. Of course they do, but they feel like others do not. So really, what is it that they need? They need others to love their neighbor as themselves. Well, duh. I mean, this whole thing in the scripture is much more simplistic than we're making it out to be. But you see, the day you die will be the day you stop loving yourself. For the suicidal people, the day they kill themselves is the day they stop loving themselves. Because you're going to love yourself to the moment you die. And Christ was teaching us to do the same for our neighbor. Are they hungry? Do they need shelter? Do they need warm clothes when it's cold? Do they need a drink when they're thirsty? These are the things to consider. And in John 14:15 it says, "If ye love me, keep my commandments." If you love the Lord Jesus Christ, then keep his commandments. Do the things he's told us to do. Abstain from idolatry. Abstain from fornication, from pornography. Abstain from theft, from murder, from covetousness, coveting after the things, your neighbor's wife, your neighbor's goods, those kind of things. Be content with what you have. There's all sorts of commandments we could go through, okay? If you love the Lord Jesus Christ, then do those things. The best thing, if you really claim you love the Lord Jesus Christ, the best thing you can do is cleanse your life and sanctify yourselves. But you see, getting churchgoers to do that is like pulling teeth. It's extremely difficult. In 2 Corinthians chapter 13, verse 5, it says, "Examine yourselves, whether ye be in the faith, and prove your own selves. Know ye not your own selves, that how Jesus Christ is in you, except ye be reprobates?" Well, examine yourselves first and foremost, not how much have I loved myself, or am I loving myself much? Examine yourselves, have I loved others enough? And how do I, and then the question comes about, how do I love others? Well, we're going to get in that in just a moment. But I'm still talking about the problem here, is when I show scriptures like this to anyone that's got some wicked actions in their life, wicked things that they're doing, and you try to rebuke that stuff and correct them, okay, they end up loving their lusts more than the Lord Jesus Christ. And that's why I like to bring up the example of Christmas so much. I mean, if you want to talk about something that destroys families, is when somebody will sanctify themselves from paganism in Christmas. But again, Jesus Christ said, I think not that I came to bring peace, I came to bring division. He said in Luke 12:51. He says, a house is going to be divided, 2 against 3 and 3 against 2. He says, where the mother against the daughter, and the daughter against the mother, and the son against the father, and the father against the son, this was going to happen. And the Lord Jesus Christ came to divide us on the truth so that way we could be sanctified. And once we are sanctified, those sanctified can unite under Christ. That's how that's supposed to work. But as in Psalm chapter 73, starting verse 20, it says, as a dream when one awaketh, so, O Lord, when thou awakest, thou shalt despise their image. The way that they're acting in their lives, he's despising these things. Thus my heart was grieved, and I was pricked in my reins. So foolish was I and ignorant. I was a beast before thee. This is the humility that we should have of ourselves. Not, oh man, we need to build ourselves up. We need to have the humility and love others. That's what we're supposed to have. But again, you know, saying that I was ignorant, a beast before thee, oh, those are negative thoughts. And Joyce Meyer says that, you know, those people are emotionally ill if they would think such a thing. See, she thinks David, King David, was just emotionally ill. But you see, Proverbs 15:10, it says, correction is grievous unto him that forsaketh the way. Oh yeah, they hate correction. They're grieved at their hearts when somebody would dare correct them because they forsake the way. In Psalm chapter 15, verse 16, it says, but unto the wicked God saith, what hast thou to do to declare my statutes, or that thou shouldest take my covenant in thy mouth, seeing thou hatest instruction and casteth my words behind thee? See, they won't speak the word of God. They'll speak what they feel, what they want to say, what tickles people's ears, because the people have itching ears and turn away from the truth and are turned into fables. Like the fables from all these heretics I quoted you at the beginning of this. Okay, they want that message. That's the feel-good, fun-time, rainbow sunshine, mashed potatoes and gravy, Oreo cookie, happy fun-time message that they just love so much. Because they hate instruction, and they cast the words of the Lord Jesus Christ behind them, but then turn around, just like we read in Jeremiah, and say, oh, we're of God, we are the temple of God, we're delivered to do these abominations. We just read that in Jeremiah chapter 7 in our first half. But let me give you the definition of the love of God. You guys want to know how you share the love of God? Listen carefully, because the Bible directly defines this. In 1 John chapter 5, in verse 3, it says, for this is the love of God. Okay, get ready. The Bible is about to tell us what the love of God is. For this is the love of God, that we keep his commandments. And his commandments are not grievous. Well, wait a second. I thought this is the love of God, that we smile to people and make sure we give them a, hey, hello, neighbor, and greet them with all happiness and cheerness and all that kind of, is that the love of God? The love of God says that we keep his commandments. I'm not saying you can't be pleasant around people. Guys, there's nothing wrong with being pleasant around people, but don't make that the foundation of love, because the Bible is not describing love in an emotion, and I'll get to that in a minute. I'm not saying love is never attached with emotion, okay? It can be, but you need to make sure there's a distinction between the two. In Romans chapter 13 and verse 10, it says, love worketh no ill toward to his neighbor. Therefore, love is the fulfilling of the law. I'm sorry, didn't love, I thought the Bible would say that love is that good time feeling we get inside. No, love is the fulfilling of the law. In 2 John 1:6, and this is love, that we walk after his commandments. That the commandment that, as ye have heard from the beginning, you should walk in it. So if you really want to love people, walk in the commandments of Jesus Christ. You see, love is the fulfilling of the law. Why do you think John 3:16 says, for God so loved the world that he gave his only begotten Son? Because his begotten Son fulfilled the law. Okay, it doesn't mean that God loves every single person. There are people he hates, just like Tim was pointing out earlier, where it said, Jacob have I loved and Esau have I hated. There are people that God hates because of their wickedness, because of their evil, okay? And that they reject him just as Esau rejected his birthright. He rejected God. And for a long time, Edom, there was a lot of bad stuff that came out of Edom, okay? Because that's what Esau was called, Edom, which means red because of his red skin. But anyway, you see how I'm hoping some of you are getting this connection now and understanding that what real love is doing what is right over what's convenient. Because if we're going to love our God and love our neighbor, the first thing we can do is clean out our sin out of our lives and sanctify ourselves from leaven. But you see, there's a bunch of false converts who enter the church. And on the one hand, they love the idea of going to heaven, but on the other hand, they want to live like the devil. They want to do all these things that make themselves feel good. It's called being a hypocrite. It's one who lives with a double heart. They don't live the way they say they believe. And that's why Psalm chapter 12 and verse 2 says, they speak vanity, everyone with his neighbor, with flattering lips and with a double heart do they speak. They give flattering lips to one another. Oh, hey, hi, yeah, oh, the weather's nice, oh, you look nice today, oh, you do too. All these flattering lips, but in their hearts they are living wickedness. And that is what the Lord Jesus Christ wants to address in their lives first and foremost. But you see, they cast his words behind them. In Proverbs chapter 11, verse 9, it says, a hypocrite with his mouth destroyeth his neighbor. Okay? A hypocrite with his mouth destroyeth his neighbor. What's a hypocrite? Someone who doesn't live the way they say they believe. But through knowledge shall the just be delivered. In Matthew chapter 23 and verse 25, it says, woe unto you, scribes and Pharisees, hypocrites, for ye make clean the outside of the cup and platter. Remember all the flattering words that they speak with a double heart? See, the double heart means, but within, they are full of exhortation and excess. They're whited sepulchres. They appear nice and beautiful on the outside, but inside they're full of dead men's bones. False converts who could care nothing for the word of God, but claim out of their mouths to be following it. Most of these people, these churchgoers in these newer churches, they don't understand the first thing about love in the Bible, because they guide themselves by their feelings. Oh, the Holy Spirit, I felt the Holy Spirit say this. You see, they're guided by their feelings in their hearts first and foremost, instead of by the Word of God, even though Jeremiah 17:9 says the heart is deceitful above all things and desperately wicked, who can know it? And in Proverbs 28:26 it says that he that trusteth in his own heart is a fool, but whoso walketh wisely, he shall be delivered. The one that is able to walk wisely in the Word of God, who humbles himself and trembles at the Word of God to follow it to the letter in the perfect preservation of his Word, at least in the King James Bible, that's the one you ought to be reading. But anyway, that's the big major deception I see, or at least one of them. I mean, there's a number of them, but a big one is that, well, if the Holy Spirit says something to me, I'll feel it. It's going to be my feelings, the direction of the Holy Spirit. It's such a contradiction in so many of the things that they do. And people want to sit back and say that love, but love is a feeling, you know, love's just a feeling. It's not actually an action. Okay, let's take a moment and let's consider your parents. Do you think your parents just absolutely had this wonderful feeling every day having to get up and take care of you? You think that's how they felt? Parents out there, have you had that? I just really want to get up there and deal with my teenager another day. I really, after they have sassed back at me with their rebellious little mouth, oh, I just really want to feed them and clothe them. Okay, that's, you know, I really feel like getting up and going to work and providing for them. It's just wonderful for me to do this. I have to say that sarcastically, because many of you have, I'm not saying you've done it, but you've had thoughts about strangling your children from time to time, but you haven't done it, okay? Why? Because you don't do everything you feel. Because if you did everything you felt, okay, you would end up probably in jail, okay? If parents did everything to their children that they felt like doing, they'd go to jail, for sure, because there would be a lot of dead children. Anyway, the thing is, the point being is that parents put aside their feelings to love their children. Do you see how this works? Love is not necessarily your emotion. Now, love sometimes can be. When you do something right for someone, you know, if you went to buy a sandwich for a homeless person to feed them, okay, and you did that because, you know, hey, I felt bad. I know what that's like not to have food. I want to go give them some food. Your emotions lined up with what was right. But your emotions do not always line up with what's right. Many times we have to put aside our emotions to do and say the right thing. And that's what the Bible is telling us, that this is the love of God, that we keep his commandments, and that love is the fulfilling of the law, that we do what's right over what's convenient. That's true love. In Genesis chapter 6 and verse 5, it says, and God saw the wickedness of man was great in the earth, and that every imagination of the thoughts of his heart was only evil continually. See, and the Bible tells us in Luke 17:26 that, and as it was in the days of Noah, so shall it be also in the days of the Son of Man. As we get closer to the time when the Lord Jesus Christ is going to come back, after all this tribulation that we're going to have, okay, that it's coming up, Christians, be prepared for this, that there's going to be no love. Everybody's going to claim that they're loving. Oh, everybody wants to claim that, because that love, that's a positive word, and we put that positivity on ourselves. It makes us feel good. It makes us feel warm and happy inside, right? Okay? But their hearts are only evil continually, meaning that they actually are not loving at all. They're speaking with a double heart. They're not being loving because they don't know the commandments of Christ. They have no interest in keeping his commandments. Now, for people that say, and there's no good thing that's going to come out of these people, you see, and there's, take this for example. They think they can get good fruit out of an evil tree. See, because in Matthew chapter 7, starting in verse 15, it says, "Beware of false prophets, which come to you in sheep's clothing, but inwardly they are ravening wolves. Even so, every good tree bringeth forth good fruit, but a corrupt tree bringeth forth evil fruit. A good tree cannot bring forth evil fruit, neither can a corrupt tree bring forth good fruit." Now, an evil tree, something, a bad tree that starts out bad, can't bring forth any good fruit. A good tree brings forth good fruit, but a good tree can be corrupted over time. So it's very interesting to see that the corruption can happen so much easier in all aspects, but there's one thing that can't happen. A tree that starts out evil cannot produce any good fruit. It's not going to happen. Now, the example has been brought up, and not just in the past, but even I think just this past week I've had to deal with people bringing up this example, where they said, well, what about take a Catholic church, for example, the Catholics that teach all this wicked heresy that's leading billions of people to hell, billions now, because they say that there's, you know, like 25% of the world is Catholic, 20 or 25%, something like that. Billions of people are on their way to hell with their hopes in a false system. And they follow their pagan god and their pagan goddess. They call Jesus and Mary. They give them those names, but they're the gods and goddesses of the pagans. And let's say they put up a hospital in a war-torn area that helps the injured. Now, to us in the flesh, we might think, "Oh, wow, that's really good. Well, I'm glad they have that hospital there." See, that's what the world considers good. But now what we want to do is look at these issues through the glasses of the Bible, according to the definitions of God, what is good. Okay, consider for a moment that once they offer their medical service, they get somebody injured, what are they going to do? Well, they said, well, they're going to share with them their false pagan message to try to convert the patients to pagan idolatry through their Catholic doctrines and convince them that they're saved by the Jesus Christ of the Bible when they're really not. What they're doing is setting up a hospital to heal them of their injuries so they can lead them to hell. How can you sit back and call that good? There is only one good, and that is God, okay? And that's the good. He defines what is good. But you see, the world has taken the word good, and they put their own definition on it. And if you dare say that something like that is not good, well, you get dragged across the coals for that kind of thing. But you see, the Bible tells us what's good and what's not good, all right? If you can save the flesh all you want, but if their soul ends up in hell, what was the point? We have to teach them the truth of the gospel, and we have to love people properly. Well, how do you love people properly? Well, you fulfill the commandments of the Lord Jesus Christ, and he told us to go teach them the things that he commanded. We are commanded that we should prophesy, meaning that we rebuke and reprove, and we exhort people. Exhort means to urge them into righteousness of the Lord Jesus Christ, no matter how much they hate us. Folks, I don't get a happy, warm, good time feeling when I start to rebuke someone. There are many times I sit back when I'm about to write an email of rebuke and I'm rolling my eyes and thinking, oh, do I really have to do this again? Because I have so much grief in my heart from having to do this over and over. I hate having to do it. I hate that because my flesh wants the same thing that a lot of other people want. You know, when I went over, I just made that whole video about you saw the Kenneth Copeland thing trying to unite with the Pope. We will talk about that stuff later. We're actually going to do a teaching. We're going to go over some of that stuff. But, you know, with all that unity, guys, my flesh wants that unity with the world. Wouldn't that be nice to be one big happy family where everybody gets along? Of course that is. But you see, my spirit that is cleansed in righteousness of the Lord Jesus Christ wants the truth of the Lord Jesus Christ more. I war against the feelings that my flesh has that wants to go into things like that and to love the Lord Jesus Christ more. and to love. Folks, I know people think that I get accused, and you guys have seen me be accused of being unloving. You guys have seen it over and over. But I argue from the scripture, not from my own personal feelings. See, those people are going by their feelings. I'm going by the word of God to say that I'm trying to teach what these people what is right, so that way they can get on the path of righteousness to be blessed by the Lord God. That is loving. That's why you hear the phrase, there's nothing more loving than the truth. There's a reason that phrase is said, because the definitions of love in the Bible are based on doing what's right over what's convenient. Now, the typical movies, Hollywood especially, does a whole lot in deceiving people on the definitions of love, because you're going to see like a typical movie or something where they'll show some sexually motivated scene, and one of the people will just passionately say, I love you. What they actually mean is that they lust after them. It's not their heart that they're thinking with. It's another piece of their anatomy they're actually thinking with. But you see, the word love sounds so much better. So they say love instead of lust, because what it really is lust. Because love would be telling somebody the truth, okay? Now, other people will say, but when I say I love you, I don't use it that way. I use it to mean that somebody is, well, that's a cherished person to me, or that they're important to me. That's what I mean it as. Well, I have a question. Why don't you just say that directly? Why don't you just say, I cherish you, or you are important to me? See, as a child growing into an adult, I cannot ever recall my parents saying, I love you, ever. And surprisingly, let me tell you this, it never bothered me, not one time. Why not? Well, because I didn't trust everything that I saw on television, okay? The TV teaches you, and they do this, it happens in real life too, it's not just the television. They sit back and say, well, my parents never told me that they loved me, so I guess I need to go to my school guidance counselor, who's probably a psychologist or psychiatrist themselves, and tell them about all my problems in my life so I can blame it on my parents, because they never said I love you. That's preposterous, okay? But that's the attitude people are going with, okay? They want to blame their parents for all their problems instead of taking responsibility and examining themselves, okay? My parents did not do everything right. I know for a fact of things both my parents did very wrong. However, I have never blamed them for my problems. I blame me for what I have done, okay? And that's the kind of repentant heart we need to have to be saved by the Lord Jesus Christ. And God gives us that repentance, but we need to be made brought low, be made humbled by the truth of His Word. Be humbled that we have done wrong, we have broken His laws. It doesn't matter how many things my parents messed up on, okay? It matters what have I done wrong. And all of us need to have that individually. Not just my parents, their perspective, they each have their own things they have to answer for as well. So even, and they can't blame their parents, you know, my grandparents, they can't blame them for those things either, okay? But you see, it never bothered me not hearing the words, I love you. And the reason for that is because in their actions, even though they messed up, in their actions, I knew that they did. One of the major ways, and I guess this is one thing I can't really understand a lot of other people on, is that there are other people that grow up with parents that would not keep their word. My parents never did. I never recall one time my parents making me a promise they did not keep. And by promise, I didn't say they never promised me anything. They never said, I promise I'll do this. They gave their word. If they said they were going to do something, they did it. Period. Well, then how did I know that they loved me? Because they kept even though they didn't even know back then, they were keeping the word of God by doing that. There's a whole bunch of Christians out there that say just tons of stuff. They just say it and they never do anything and think that they're not liars. See, my parents didn't lie to me. That was the best part. Because they did what they said they would do. And that they were being honest with me, and in that they were loving me by showing me a proper example and never lying to me. They didn't even realize they were keeping the word of God by doing that, okay? And I couldn't imagine growing up in a household where somebody lies to you like that continually. They never keep their word. And when I say biblically, I also mean from like 2 Corinthians chapter 8, verse 8, where it says, I speak not by commandment, but by occasion of the forwardness of others, and to prove the sincerity of your love. Not to sit back and say it. You see, because in the Bible, there are only a couple times where the phrase, I love you, is used, but it's used from a third-person perspective. It's not a first person that, like, he's telling them, I love you. It's used from a third person, a second or third person perspective, describing something. The phrase, I love you, as it's used today, is never used in the Bible. Because the Bible tells us to prove the sincerity of your love by demonstrating it. Don't talk about it, demonstrate it. Now, I was going online, I was looking up a few things, and I found this from this girl named Karen, who wrote this on a website called An Experience Project. She wrote a post called I Hate My Parents. Let's listen to what she says here. Quote, I am so tired of the empty promises my parents always give me. My mom and I would plan all week to go out on the weekend. Then when Friday makes its way around, she goes out with her friends. She comes home and says, I'm tired, honey, you understand, maybe next time. I hate having my time wasted. It's like my time does not matter to her. Do you see how the parent is now demeaning the child, that they mean nothing to them by their actions, okay? Her mom did wickedness here. She continues and says, if I say something about it, she turns the tables on me. I'm coming to the point where when someone makes me a promise, I don't even get my hopes up. When you hope, you only get shot down. There's no point to it, end quote. Do you see how by lying to, you see, what the, when she gave her, when she, the mother gave the daughter her word, she was going to do something, didn't do it, she's a liar. The Bible says when you lie to someone, you hate the person that was deceived by your lie. That's what the Bible tells us. I have a whole article where we quote all the scripture on that. If you just type in the word lies at creationliberty.com, there's an article called God Does Not Justify Lies. We did a whole teaching on this, okay? But go into that, read that carefully. The Bible says that you hate the person that you lied to. I don't care how much you say, no, I love them, I love them. The Bible says you hate them. And the Bible also says that any man that hateth his brother is a murderer at heart. The Bible, if you give your word and you don't keep it, the Bible says that's the equivalent of murder. That you killed someone by doing that. Christians do not take that seriously enough. They just say whatever, and Lorraine could tell you story after story after story of places we have been, churches we have gone to, where people have told us things that they were going to do. Oh yeah, we're going to sow into your ministry monthly. Oh yeah, we're going to support you. Yeah, I'm going to get you into our church, blah, blah, blah. I mean, they give promise after promise after promise. And Lorraine, could you tell me how many of those promises that people made that you can recall that they actually came through on?
Zero.
You can't recall any instances of that. Neither can I. Thank you. I just wanted somebody else to say it besides me.
Well, okay. I completely agree with that girl who was saying she hated her parents and sitting there going, yeah, you know, in terms of, you know, people keeping their word and stuff, or, you know, it's anymore. It's rare, especially when, like, it comes to, like, the ministry and stuff. It's like people will say stuff and you're just like, uh-huh, prove it.
Yeah, right. You're right. And how many times have you and I been let down by other Christians who've done this?
Well, until we stop believing them.
Yeah, we've gotten to do you remember the last time we went to a church? One of the things I said at the very end, now I don't know whether you remember this, Lorraine, or not, but at the very end of the presentation, I told them, I gave them the scriptures on that, to be careful what you say to us.
Yeah, I remember that.
And how many people came up afterwards and promised us anything?
None.
Not one. Exactly. Thank you, Lorraine, I appreciate that. So, anyway, not one person, after I warned them what the scripture said, came up and gave us their word about anything. So you see how it's so ingrained to them in this New Age church to just say whatever they want and not have to do anything about it. Like, they're not held accountable for their words. Folks, Matthew chapter 12 and verse 36 says, but I say unto you that every idle word that men shall speak, they shall give account thereof in the day of judgment. Did that say that Christians are an exemption from that? Even though we go to a different judgment seat, we go to the judgment seat of Christ, we are still going to have to give an account for the idle words we speak. In Psalm 31:18, it says, let the lying lips be put to silence. Amen. Let the lying lips be put to silence. If you cannot keep your word, then shut up. Say nothing. Ecclesiastes chapter 5, verse 5, it says, better it is that thou shouldest not vow than thou shouldest vow and not pay. Proverbs chapter 10 and verse 18, he that hideth hatred with lying lips, that's what it's talking about there. They're hiding hatred. He that uttereth a slander is a fool, okay? When they're hiding their hatred with their lying lips. There's hatred in their hearts, the Bible says, even though they try to desperately say, oh, no, that's not the case. Now, even according to the world, if you actually went into, you know, like I've debated with some of these atheists and evolutionists in the past on our podcast show, if you take a moment to analyze the love from an atheistic and evolutionary worldview, because after all, that's the philosophy that they're taught in the public school system, all these children are taught. What is love if evolution is true? You see, love is abstract. That means not concrete, meaning abstract, meaning it's just love and hatred and things like that. They're abstract concepts. They're not physical to where you can touch them. Anything that you can sense with your five senses is what's called concrete. And a lot of abstract and concrete stuff, that's talked about a lot in art school and things like that, people, because they'll do abstract art as opposed to concrete art and things like that. Abstract art has always been kind of senseless to me, but that's a whole other thing. That's just my opinion. Who cares? Anyway, so, but love is abstract. And since atheism and evolutionism only considers that which is material to exist, then love is simply a combination of chemical processes that's happening in your brain. And that they just produce a given result, just like, you know, you're mixing around chemicals in chemistry class. It's just a chemical combination that gives a certain result. So the result of love is just this chemical combination that makes you desire or want for a given person, place, or thing. That means in the evolutionary worldview, love is just a chemical reaction, and saying I love you to someone else is no different than passing gas. It's just a combination of chemicals that has a physical cause and effect reaction. Now, I had one atheist one time sit there and say, I disagree with that. And that's all I said. Because he has no basis on which to disagree with it. There's no argument you could make for that, because in order to do that, you would have to argue for something abstract, and you can't prove that exists in an atheist and evolutionary worldview. So anyway, the Bible, like I said before, never uses the phrase, I love you, in that context. And that's where, if you take, for example, in 2 Corinthians 11:11, it says, wherefore, because I love you not, God knoweth. See, Paul's explaining in that specific instance that he was boasting of other regions where he had spread the gospel. It did not mean that he did not love the congregation of Corinth. He was just very happy for these other regions in which the gospel was being spread. And he tells them there that they may not feel a certain way towards him, but God knows the truth. That means their feelings are irrelevant when it comes to the facts. I mean, go ahead and go back through 2 Corinthians 11 and read it for yourself to gain that understanding. 2 Corinthians 12. I will very gladly spend and be spent for you, though the more abundantly I love you, the less I be loved. Now, Paul's not telling them directly, I love you, in the sense that we say it today. He's pointing out that he has been loving to them by giving and giving unto them, but the more he gives of himself, the less he is loved. Okay? And that's a lot of that is due to their wickedness, actually, in 2 Corinthians. If you go back to 2 Corinthians 12:20 and read through that, he mentions that later, that it's through their wickedness that he's not being loved as much, is because the more and more he does for them, the less they end up doing. And he's rebuking them in that position. So anyway, the point being is that true biblical teaching shows us that to love ourselves last, not to love ourselves first, to love ourselves last. And to love others as we already love ourselves. And there are some churchgoers who are going to argue what I'm teaching here, saying, well, the Bible tells us love is patient and love is kind, Chris. You got to go to the emotions of those things, because love is patient, love is kind. That is not what the Bible says. That's what your New Age Bible tells you. I'm going to go to 1 Corinthians chapter 13, starting in verse 3. And it says, and though I bestow all my goods to feed the poor, and though I give my body to be burned, and have not charity, it profiteth me nothing. So, I mean, you can give your goods to the poor and not be charitable. Folks, I'm going to work on a teaching in the near future here on charity in general, and we're going to talk about these issues, because a lot of people, it's not just love, people don't have a concept of what charity means either. And you'd be surprised once we go through all the definitions of charity used in the Bible of what it talks about depending on the different contexts it's being referred to. But you can give all your goods to feed the poor and don't have charity. And it says, and it profit me nothing. Well, why? It says, because charity suffereth long and is kind. Charity envieth not. Charity vaunteth not itself and is not puffed up. You see, if you put the word love here, and love being the fulfillment of the law, there would be a contradiction in Scripture. Charity here is the key, because God loveth the cheerful giver. That's the charitable person. He says, doth not behave itself seemly, and seeketh not her own, is not easily provoked, thinketh no evil, rejoiceth not in iniquity, but rejoiceth in truth, beareth all things, believeth all things, hopeth all things, endureth all things. Charity never faileth. Okay, and when it says all things, it's talking about within the context of the specific 1 Corinthians chapter 13, okay? I don't want to give people the wrong impression. That's why I made that demotivational poster you guys saw I posted the other week, where it has the guy jumping off a building to his death, and he's screaming on the way down, I can do all things through Christ who strengthens me. And I just put context, you're doing it wrong. Because you have to look, when it says all things, you have to look at the context in which all things is being said. That's like when if somebody's talking about, what is that thing, what do you call that, the ultimate fighting championship, or they call that UFC? I guess is what, if I have that right, if I said it wrong, I'm sorry. I've never seen it or anything like that. But it's got these guys who are, I guess, like kickboxers and stuff and fighters, and they fight and what all that. If somebody's getting really excited about UFC and they go, oh man, that guy was beating up everybody. You know, they're getting excited about their favorite person. When he says they're beating up everybody, does that mean he went through the entire audience of the auditorium and beat up every single person there? No, when he says beating up everybody, he's talking about within the context of the fighters who are participating in the tournament. We still use that kind of language today. But you see, the only time it's criticized is in the Bible, because people hate the Word of God. Because it rebukes them. It tries to set them right, to become righteous, and they hate that kind of stuff, and they want to turn from Him. So that's the only kind of place they're going to try to claim there's contradictions in God's Word, even though they use the exact same language today. But you see, it's from the places like the Wicked NIV that says love is patient, love is kind. You're using a New Age Bible is where you're pulling that from, okay? According to the Bible, without the Lord God, it's impossible to have love. In 1 John 4:7, it says, Beloved, let us love one another, for love is of God, and everyone that loveth is born of God and knoweth God. Okay? Because those, again, everyone that loveth, who's loving? Those who keep the commandments of God and rebuke and reprove with all longsuffering and doctrine, okay? And rebuke sharply that they may be sound in the faith so they can receive the blessings of God. Those are the people who love, according to the Bible. But you see, according to the world, they give a totally different definition. Because in the beginning was the Word, and the Word was with God, and the Word was God in John 1:1. And he that loveth not knoweth not God, for God is love. See, God's Word is love. In 1 John 4:16, it says, And we have known and believed the love that God hath to us. God is love. And he that dwelleth in love dwelleth in God, and God in him. So without the Word of God, love doesn't exist. Even if someone wanted to say that love existed outside of God, it would be impossible to prove. So, I mean, it's just as it would be impossible to prove the existence of love or logic or any of those kind of things, any kind of reasoning in an atheistic universe, okay? But just as like morality, right and wrong, can't be proven to be exist without the Christian God of the Bible, so love too can't be proven to exist without the Christian God of the Bible. Again, you have to go into an article we have on atheists can't justify morals. You can just type in morality into the search bar at creationliberty.com. You can find an article on that. But I have a lot of these articles I'm talking about, I have links to them from this article as well, the one that we're talking about today. But anyway, I hope Christians are going to walk away from this with a better understanding of God's definition of love. And to love God is to keep His commandments. And if you truly love your Christian brethren and you love the Lord Jesus Christ, you will rebuke them when they do wickedness. In 2 Timothy chapter 3, verse 16, it says, All Scripture is given by inspiration of God and is profitable for doctrine, for reproof, for correction, for instruction in righteousness. In Titus chapter 2, starting in verse 11, it says, For the grace of God that bringeth salvation hath appeared unto all men, teaching us that, denying ungodliness and worldly lusts, we should live soberly, righteously, and godly in this present world. Well, you don't hear that preached a whole lot from behind the pulpits of these New Age church buildings out here. Looking for that blessed hope, and with the glorious appearance of the great God and our Savior Jesus Christ, who gave himself for us that he might redeem us from all iniquity and purify unto himself a peculiar people, zealous of good works. These things speak and exhort and rebuke with all authority. Let no man despise thee. In 2 Timothy chapter 4, verse 2, it says, preach the word, be instant, in season, out of season. Reprove, rebuke, exhort with all longsuffering and doctrine. And the Lord Jesus Christ rebukes those he loves. And this is what I'm talking about here. Listen to this. In Revelation 3:19, it says, as many as I love, I rebuke and chasten. Why? Because to love someone is to keep the commandments of God. So as many as I love, I rebuke and chasten. Be zealous, therefore, and repent. That's what he's trying to tell to this Laodicean church that's so lazy and lukewarm and won't hear the word of God. He's calling them to repentance. There's a lot of people, and folks, I have to rebuke myself too, because there have been times where I have held back certain words that needed to be said because I really cared about somebody, because I really loved them and favored them, and I don't want to say the word love. I favored them in such a way. I had emotions toward that person and wanted to be really careful and gentle with that person, but I found out that me holding that back was a bad thing, because as soon as it came out, they had nothing more to do with me. And really, in my heart, I have had, folks, just like you guys, I have had instances where I have made that mistake too. I'm ashamed that I've ever made that mistake as a born-again Christian. But I need to stay vigilant onto these things and be consistent in trying to love other people. Because in Proverbs 27:5, listen to this carefully, folks, open rebuke is better than secret love. Okay? To try to love someone in secret is not going to work here. You need that open rebuke. Do we love our family and friends more than the Lord Jesus Christ? Well, Matthew chapter 10, verse 37 says, he that loveth father or mother more than me is not worthy of me. He that loveth son or daughter more than me is not worthy of me. Now, the definition of love, depending on the context, can be used in terms of favor. Okay? In some contexts, as we've seen here, it's used as keeping the commandments of God. When it says that loveth father or mother, that means you favor them more than you favor Christ. Again, you have to keep looking at the context to understand it. You can rebuke people and reprove people in a charitable manner. Most people don't realize you can do that, okay? And even I have a lot of work to do to make sure that I do that, okay? This is just as much rebuke for me as it is for other people, all right? But no matter how kind you try to be, often that rebuked person will hate you and continue on in his or her error. That's one thing you have to keep in mind when you're doing it. Don't expect that everybody is just going to come around to the knowledge of the truth of God's word like you have, because you have to remember that born-again Christians are given a love of the truth. And there are many people out there who are not born-again Christians, who are claiming to be of Christ. They're called false brethren, false converts. In Proverbs chapter 10, verse 17, it says, he is in the way of life that keepeth instruction, but he that refuseth reproof erreth. And that's another way you can know, that's another one of the King James Bible has a built-in dictionary into it. It says that he that refuseth reproof. It uses reproof and instruction in the same, they use the words interchangeably there. So that's how you know what reproof means. That's the proper instruction in the Word of God. And in Proverbs 12:1, it says, whoso loveth instruction loveth knowledge, but he that hateth reproof is brutish. And again, in Proverbs 15, just like I quoted earlier, correction is grievous unto him that forsaketh the way. So, anyway, folks, I'm not saying that being loving is, I'm saying this again, is detached from emotion. Sometimes your emotions can line up with it. But many times your emotions are not going to line up with being loving towards someone. And so what you need to do is learn to be adults. Don't be children in your understanding, all right? Whining and trying to get your way, we should be men in our understanding, the Bible tells us, okay? Be in your malice, be ye children, but in understanding, be men. And in that understanding, we need to understand to put aside our childish emotions, the things we want, in order to do what is right. That is being loving, to do what's right over what's convenient. And I struggle still to this day, even after doing ministry for the past, we've been doing this for about 6.5 years now, I still struggle to find Christians that will do what's right over what's convenient. And folks, I hope that as you continue, and continue to study these verses about the loving God, because there's more beyond this, I just wanted to keep this teaching very simple, okay? But as you continue to study the Word, keep those things in mind, And pray about that. Pray about showing that if you don't know whether you're being truly loving according to God's word or not, pray that he would show you what those things are and then give you opportunities to practice it in real life. And some of you might be a little nervous about having to stand up and rebuke someone else, to be loving, to give them the truth, all right? But these are things that we are commanded to do, and that you're not alone. Again, we have to. The Bible says that we endure afflictions. Affliction is grief. We endure grief to make full proof of our ministry. That's what we're supposed to do. And so, yes, you're going to suffer a lot of grief, but just because you're suffering that grief on behalf of somebody else to do what's right over what's convenient, but and that's how you love them, okay? Yeah, the bottom line is, if you claim to truly love your Christian brethren, you're going to rebuke them if they err from the Word of God. And we pray not only that they would keep, that God, you would open their eyes to the truth, but also at the same time, a good practice, and I'm not saying this is required of you, but a good practice and rule of thumb I like to have is, if I pray it for somebody else, I pray it for myself as well. Lord, not only open their eyes, but keep my eyes open to the truth so that I'm not blinded, and that he would give them repentance to acknowledge the truth, and Lord, make me to repent of things that I don't know that I need to repent of at this time. Open my eyes, let me see the world the way you see it. And let me see my flesh the way you see it, not the way I want to feel about it. Okay? Let's put aside our emotions and do what's right. And that's where we'll end for today. Did anybody have any questions or comments about this teaching before we close today? Well, thanks for joining us, everybody. And may our Lord Jesus Christ bless you all as you study his word to glorify him in all the things that you do. And we will see you next week.